really sorry.
That's a good problem.
Hello, everyone. We'll begin in about 5 minutes. We'll give people a few more minutes to sign in and grab some lunch.
Everything.
Yes.
Good.
Very good.
Hello.
Whatever you want. I guess you'll be standing for a while.
Yeah, exactly.
You gotta take a scene.
So you're the intern at Spicy, or what's
your
role?
Yeah, I'm the intern. So I work part-time and then I do full-time in school as well.
Okay. Where are you at?
At the George Washington University.
Okay.
Yeah.
Studying psychology?
I'm minoring in psychology and majoring in organizational sciences and also dance.
Dance, nice. It's good to have a little bit of
that. Exactly. I just forgot everything.
So in psychology, there's Mogadam is there, right?
There's
Fateli Mogadam? One of the faculty works on... Okay, because he works on...
Dawkins and... goodness, I haven't had a psych class in a while, but I love what we've learned. I've done social, developmental, health, cognitive, and then obviously behavioral. Mm-hmm.
And then you want to go into organizational behavior afterwards?
I think so, yeah. I took industrial organizational sciences, and like IO psychology, I'm sorry, industrial organizational psychology, and I loved it. I think it's... I think it'd be really helpful to improve workplaces because I think that's what'll make everybody more productive and happy. And, yeah. So, and I mean, in Europe, people get such like great like days off and healthcare and just like everything like that. And I think if we improve that, then we're gonna improve people in general.
Yeah.
I don't know. I just love the idea of that.
Yeah.
And then I'm a dancer as well. I love dance.
Yeah. Nice. What kind of dance do you focus on?
I do more classical things, but we also
ballet.
Ballet more, all those things, like kind of more collegiate things. Uh-huh. But then also I'm on the team with Victor and Brad for hip hop.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so it's fun. That's how I kind of found out about this.
Okay, funny.
You ready to begin?
Sure, shall I stand there?
I'll say a word or two and then I'll transition.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Sarah Mancall. I'm the Policy Director for the Society for the Psychological Study of Social Issues. It's a mouthful. We go by SPSSI. We are a scientific association of psychologists and other social scientists who study social issues that we would like to better understand and inform. So I have a few thank yous today. First, I want to thank the Office of Congressman McGovern, especially Kim Stanton. Congressman McGovern is co-chair of the Tom Lantos Human Rights Commission, and this was a particular interest of the commission's that we look at the psychological effects of genocide and really get at why it happens, how it happens, and what we can do in the aftermath. I also want to thank our speaker, Johanna Volhart, and our wonderful staff members. We have Morgan, our undergraduate intern, Brad Sickles, and Vic, who's just outside. So before I introduce the speaker, I want to let you know that we are streaming live on Facebook, and after this event, we will post the video to our YouTube page, and I'll follow up with an email so that you'll have all of those details, including a copy of the slides. And now, on to our speaker. So Dr. Johanna Ray Volhart is an associate professor in the Francis L. Hyatt School of Psychology at Clark University. She directs the psychology PhD program there. She co-directs the Peace Studies program, and she serves as an affiliated faculty member of the Strassler Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies. In addition, Dr. Volhart is vice president of the International Society of Political Psychology and a co-editor of the Journal of Social and Political Psychology. She received her master's degree in psychology from the University of Cologne, and she received a PhD in social psychology with a concentration in the psychology of peace and violence from the University of Massachusetts Amherst. Regarding her scholarship, Dr. Volhart focuses on the psychological impact of collective victimization on relations with members of other groups, opinions on social and political issues, and psychological well-being. Her current research projects include developing measures of inclusive and exclusive victim consciousness, the psychological consequences of acknowledgement versus denial of collective victimization, resistance during the Holocaust, and media-based reconciliation interventions. Dr. Volhart conducts this research using multiple methods, experiments in the lab, field experiments, surveys, content analysis, archival research, interviews, and focus groups. She has worked with various ethnic, religious, and national minority groups in the US, Europe, South Asia, and East Africa. We will have her present for about 30, 40 minutes, and then we'll do some Q&A afterwards. You can ask her questions.
Thank you. All right, so thank you everyone for being here, and thank you to SPSSI for organizing this great opportunity. I look forward to sharing some of the insights we have from social psychology on what can help us understand why genocide occurs from a psychological perspective, and also what happens in the aftermath. So let me first start by talking very briefly about what a psychological perspective on genocide might be, because that is probably less familiar to many of you, this particular perspective. So social psychologists or psychologists in general who study genocide might ask questions such as, why do people kill? What enables us to carry out atrocities? How do people who are targeted in genocide survive such extreme experiences? And what do they experience once the violence has ended? What makes some bystanders help and others stand by helplessly? And why is reconciliation in the aftermath of genocide so challenging? Why does genocide continue to affect societies, even generations later? And obviously, I will not be able to answer all of these questions in this short talk or provide a complete summary of what we know in the field. So I am hoping that we can discuss some of the issues in more detail in the question and answer session. But what I will talk about in this talk is I will focus on a few myths or misperceptions that we may have of the psychology of genocide from the perspective of victim, perpetrator, and bystander groups about how genocide works, psychologically speaking. And I will also talk about some of the key issues that make the aftermath of genocide so challenging. So why cycles of violence occur in the aftermath of genocide as opposed to successful reconciliation and healing, and why this is so hard and oftentimes so entrenched, and some of the obstacles that may occur for psychological reasons and that get into the way of work of policymakers and practitioners working on this field, on these issues. And actually, most of my work focuses on the aftermath of genocide. However, in this talk, I will focus mostly on genocide per se, and I hope that we will get to discussing more about the aftermath of genocide and the importance of paying attention to what happens there in the Q&A session. So first, just a few definitions so that we're all on the same page about what we're talking about. You probably are familiar with the common definition that is used by the UN, which defines genocide as acts committed with the intent to destroy in whole or in part a national, ethnic, racial, or religious group. This is the classic definition proposed by Lemkin. And this includes killing, but it also includes inflicting life conditions that are aimed at physical destruction. For example, imposing measures to prevent birth, forcibly transferring children, and many other tactics that we might not typically think of. Also, perhaps less familiar or less known, is that Lemkin's original definition also included a coordinated plan of actions aiming at the destruction of the essential foundations of the life of national groups. So this includes, in his words, disintegration of political and social institutions, of culture, language, national feelings, religion, and the economic existence of national groups. So as you can imagine, this would actually address instances of colonization, of occupation, and other events, occurrences that we typically do not think of as genocide. And I mention this now because later on in the talk I will talk about how our prototype of what typical genocide looks like may inform how we react to what is going on in the world, where we intervene and where we don't. This definition has some limitations in some ways. So, for example, it doesn't include some other cases of genocide that have been committed on the basis of political ideology or social class. So, for example, we can think of the Cambodian genocide or the Holodomor. So, some scholars, such as political scientist Scott Strauss, have instead used the definition of genocide as a form of extensive group selective violence, whose purpose is the destruction of that group in a territory under the control of the perpetrator. And this extension to group selective violence can then include targeting groups based on class, ideology, or really any other kind of social category that humans come up with. The other problem with this definition is that genocide is hard to prove because of the nature of proving intent. And as you know, this is a very controversial issue, and there are many cases where people struggle for decades, if not centuries, to have genocide, well, centuries not yet, but decades to have mass atrocities recognized as genocide. So for this reason, it is important to also take into account a broader definition of mass atrocities that includes genocide, but also other widespread attacks against civilians, such as crimes against humanity, war crimes, and ethnic cleansing. And Strauss notes that these can be group selective, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. Now, for psychologists, the distinction between genocide and mass atrocities is actually not as important as it may be for legal scholars or policymakers who have to work with these laws, because psychologically, the experience of being targeted, the experience of existential threat and loss of life is pretty much the same, whether it is later labeled a genocide or a mass atrocity. Also, the motives that lead to or allow people to engage in killing, as I will talk about in a few moments, also are not that different between mass atrocities and specifically genocide. So for psychologists, this distinction is less important. What is important, however, is this distinction between group selective and other forms of violence, because the group selective nature of violence is something that social psychologists know a lot about, and it does change some of the processes that are involved in these cases. Now, another distinction that we should perhaps briefly talk about is this distinction between the victim, perpetrator, and bystander group. This is a distinction that is commonly used when we talk about genocide or other forms of violence. But it is important to note that these three roles are actually not always so distinct as it might seem. So there are cases where perpetrators are also engaged in acts of rescue. There are cases where bystander groups become rescuers and are then targeted and become victims as a result. And there are victim groups who collaborate with perpetrators in order to save their lives. So these distinctions are blurry, again, from a psychological perspective. And this is also important to keep in mind when we think about these issues. So now I will start addressing some of the common myths or misperceptions that we often have in our lay understanding of genocide and the psychology of genocide. One general overarching misperception is that genocide is something categorically different from normal human behavior, that it is outside of the realm of normal psychological processes and therefore cannot easily be understood. And of course, in general, for most of us who are fortunate to never experience a genocide, it is indeed very difficult to imagine this experience, whether from the perspective of witnessing it, or being targeted, or committing the atrocities. However, this does not mean that we cannot understand it by studying ordinary psychological processes that also occur in times of relative peace, or what we may consider as such. So my point here is that the basic psychological processes that drive genocide and behavior during genocide and enable people to kill or to look away when others kill are the same as in times of relative peace. They just differ in terms of their scale and in terms of their outcomes. And I will give you several examples in a moment to clarify this. The difference that we need to keep in mind, or one of the main differences that help explain the outcome, is that there is a certain political or social context in place that enables these very same processes to lead to more and more destructive behaviors. So specifically in times of relative peace, under stable democracies and so on, there will be limits and boundaries regarding how far these behaviors can go and which outcomes they can give rise to that are still considered as normative in society. And again, I will give a few examples in a moment that will help explain this. There are, however, then certain societal and political conditions that will allow for the escalation of these ordinary processes into genocide. And here the work by political scientist Barbara Harf is very interesting and important. She conducted an analysis of 126 cases of regime collapse and unstable conditions between 1955 and 1997, and she found that the following conditions you can see here were the main predictors that helped differentiate those 35 cases that led ultimately to genocide from those cases that did not result in genocide in this context of instability and regime collapse. So the factors that she found as predicting genocide were political upheaval, prior genocide. This is very important when we come to discussing why the aftermath of genocide is particularly important to pay attention to. Autocratic as opposed to democratic rule, exclusionary ideology, having an elite ethnic minority in power, as well as low trade openness, which I think essentially is simply an indicator of isolation from nations that you often see when genocide occurs. So these are the societal and political conditions to allow those normal, ordinary psychological processes that we see in times of peace to escalate and give rise to extreme violent behavior that we then call genocide. Erwin Staub, who is a pioneer on the psychology of genocide, has called this escalation of first seemingly harmless processes into genocide a continuum of destruction. So again, the idea is that it is a gradual development, that this is basically a scale of escalating behaviors, rather than that at some point cross a certain threshold that we then call genocide, rather than being a categorically distinct form of behaviors that that occur. And obviously what this means is when we're talking about a spectrum of gradually increasing acts of violence and exclusion, this has implications for early warning and for early intervention when it is still possible, when things have not escalated yet as much that it is not possible to intervene. So now I'm going to talk about some of the processes that help explain how people commit genocide, as well as engage in other less severe forms of violence in times of relative peace. And one such example is dehumanization. I think this is pretty well known by now that in every genocide, perpetrator groups refer to their targets in terms that describe them as less than human, as animals, or as other creatures. So some of the more well-known examples that we have are, for example, the Holocaust, where Jews were referred to as rats, as vermin, as snakes, or the Rwandan genocide. This is here on this side. This is an image from Hutu Power magazine, where Tutsis were referred to as cockroaches. But we have similar examples in many other contexts as well. Darfur, this has been documented in many other contexts of genocide. So why does this happen and how does this work? The simple idea is that this is not just a derogation of the victim group, but it also makes it easier and less aversive for people to kill, given that we have different moral standards for killing humans versus animals. Importantly, though, this does not only happen during genocide. This also happens in times of war and in other contexts. This happens not just in other continents, but also in our US context. Here are a few examples of various US wars in the past and in the present where dehumanization is obvious. It also happens among ordinary citizens in the present. So for example, social psychologist Noor Kteli at Northwestern University has conducted a solid line of research in looking at many different studies in several different countries which show the prevalence of blatant dehumanization in our society today. So he and his colleagues measure blatant dehumanization with this scale that you see here, which is essentially showing the ascent of humankind from ape to Homo sapiens. And in his studies, he simply asks people to show on the slider where they would place each group or nation that they are asked about along this scale. And what they find is a considerable degree of dehumanization, given the blatant nature of the scale, especially towards here now in the present, Mexican immigrants, Arabs, and Muslims. Those are the groups that were perceived as less than human on this scale. Importantly, dehumanization also has consequences in non-war, non-genocidal contexts. So for example, across several studies among people residing in the US, Kteli and his colleagues showed that the more people dehumanized, so the more they agreed or put people on this slide more to the left, the less likely they were to support Arab immigration, the more likely they were to support violent counterterrorism strategies, including waterboarding, also bombing of civilians. They showed more support for drone strikes in Afghanistan and Pakistan, more support for vengeance, measured with statements such as Muslims bombed Boston, this is the Boston Marathon bombing, we as a planet need to wipe them off the world, off this world, every one of them. Dehumanization also predicted more negative attitudes towards Mexican immigrants and more support for anti-immigration policies, including more extreme measures such as solitary confinement during detention. Dehumanization is one of the so-called moral disengagement strategies that Albert Bandura has identified. Moral disengagement allows us to maintain a positive image of ourselves and of our group while committing or supporting atrocities or other behaviors that would be otherwise considered as immoral. Because everyone wants to consider themselves as a good human being, even people who commit violence. So how do we do this psychologically? As I just mentioned, one of the strategies is dehumanization. Other strategies include moral justification of atrocities, for example, if we don't attack, we will be killed ourselves. Sanitizing or euphemizing language, for example, in the Rwandan genocide, in the radio, they broadcasted messages asking people to go to work, which was a term that was used to say go out and kill. today we use here terms such as enhanced interrogation techniques or collateral damage that really cover up the harm that is being done. Another strategy are advantageous comparisons, for example, sacrificing a few to save thousands. Displacement or diffusion of responsibility, statements such as we were only following orders, it was someone else, or it was a diffuse group of people who were responsible. Or the distortion of harmful consequences, so for example, underreporting the number of deaths or other harmful consequences that occur. And again, some of these justifications will sound very familiar to you, not just from context of genocide, but from actions we are engaged in today in our society. So it is again a spectrum that we see already in times of what we consider to be relatively peaceful and democratic, but that also helps explain processes during genocide. Finally, another process I want to highlight that helps explain the gradual escalation of violence to genocide, and that is parallel to processes we see, again, in times of relative peace, is that of desensitization to violence. This has been studied a lot, for example, in the context of media violence, looking at how kids become used to violence and desensitized, but it also helps explain how people become ready to kill. Because it is important to note that committing violence is aversive. It is not something that most human beings enjoy doing. In fact, most people try to avoid it, and there is substantial evidence for that. So for example, a study on soldiers in World War II showed that many actually misfired or deliberately misfired or didn't fire at all when they had an opportunity of you know, not being observed. Similarly, during the Holocaust, the gas chambers of the concentration camps were built after Nazi officials in Berlin were getting frustrated with reports from the soldiers on the Eastern Front who had enormous difficulties in carrying out the mass shootings of Jews in the forest, which is how the killings during the Holocaust were originally carried out. They had to find strategies that were less aversive to these soldiers by removing them from the act of violence. Another indicator of how aversive and difficult it is for people to kill is the role of alcohol and other drugs in genocide. We see this in many different cases and accounts. For example, in the Rwandan genocide, perpetrators were given crates of beer and other drugs at the end of the day or before going out to kill. And we see this, as I said before, in many other genocides as well. Also, the high prevalence of PTSD among soldiers who return from combat is another indicator of how unnatural the act of killing is to human beings. So then how do we explain why people continue to engage in it? One finding is that committing violence actually makes people more and not less likely to engage in future violence once they have been coerced into it, for example, through initiation rites or peer pressure or coercion. We can think of examples from child soldiers who often have to be forced to commit their first killing, and then it becomes more natural. And this happens for both psychological and physiological reasons. So physiologically, our body simply habituates to aversive stimuli. When we are exposed repeatedly, we react less strongly with each time it is repeated, which is, of course, an adaptive strategy for individual well-being, but has harmful consequences for violence escalation. And psychologically, we may experience dissonance after committing violence, because, again, for most people, violence has negative moral implications. This is part of every religion and every society. And it is at odds with our desire to see ourselves in a positive light and be a good human being. So when we experience such a disconnect of what we think of ourselves and what we actually do, or our self-concept and our action, we will often change one or the other in order to bring the two in line with each other, because this dissonance, this disagreement is aversive to us and uncomfortable. In times of violence, not committing violence with others around you can have severe risks, even being killed yourself. So a more likely route then is that people will gradually change their attitudes towards the killing. And this may come also with a shift in identity, that you may change your self-concept of who you are and what you are capable of, which obviously then explains why it becomes easier for people to continue engaging in killing. And this is apparent in some of the interviews with child soldiers, for example. However, speaking of identity, group identity per se is not one of the processes that easily explains genocide, despite the myth that exists around this. So a common misperception is that identities kill. especially when we talk about genocide in Rwanda, but also in the Balkans, or other places that we don't know or understand as well, there's often this idea and stereotype of ancient tribal hatred that led to the killings. In other words, genocide is blamed on group identities, on strong group ties and identities. And here are two examples of actually really good books on the topic that kind of perpetuate this idea that identities kill. Now, obviously, group identities are involved and invoked in genocide and are used to mobilize group members to participate in violence. Because of this, we may come to the conclusion that the most effective form of genocide prevention would be to get people to disengage from identifying with their group, with their nation, their religion, or their ethnic group. We might think identities per se are the problem. However, this is obviously neither particularly practical, nor is it necessary, and it can even undermine some positive effects of group identification. Social psychologists point out that in-group love is not the same as out-group hatred, or put differently, just because you are attached to your group, you do not necessarily have to derogate and engage in violence against other groups. It is important to distinguish between more benign forms of in-group identification that don't have these negative effects on relations with other groups and forms of in-group identification that do predict support for violence. So for example, Sonia Rokas and her colleagues have distinguished between in-group attachment, which is simply liking your group, feeling that you are a member and this is something you value, versus in-group glorification, where you put your group above others and think your group is superior to others. And it is only this latter form, not the former, that predicts support for violence in different contexts. Similarly, patriotism can be blind or it can be constructive, and constructive patriotism can include criticism of one's group to hold it to higher moral standards and have higher expectations for justice. And this obviously would not predict violence, but the opposite. So in other words, it is the content of your group identity and how you define and fill it with values and norms that matters, and not just the strength of identification per se. Certain forms of identity content can even be used for genocide prevention and intervention. For example, in one archival study of documents from Bulgaria during World War II, researchers showed that appealing to the historically grounded idea that the core aspect of Bulgarian identity was to rescue others in need or to help others who are under attack, actually helped mobilize Bulgarian citizens to get behind the idea of saving Bulgaria's Jews rather than delivering them to the Germans. Now I will talk about a common misperception that exists of victim groups, namely that they go like lambs to the slaughter. Frequently, victim groups are depicted as weak and passive, and we wonder, how could they let this happen to themselves? Why didn't they resist? Why didn't they do more to prevent this themselves? However, the degree and amount of agency and resistance that is exhibited by members of targeted groups is underestimated. And likewise, we tend to underestimate how available information is to those who are under attack, and how people calculate their options and weigh the risks and benefits of resisting. Human beings suffer, if you wish, from a positivity bias or optimistic bias. We tend to think that bad things happening to others will not happen to us, and we overestimate our chances of survival. For example, there are some historical analyses of documents suggesting that inhabitants of the ghetto in Łódź, which is the one picture on the top, were fooled by Nazis to believe that they could survive if they worked hard enough in this ghetto that was set up like a regular town and that was isolated from information about what was happening to Jews further in the east. In contrast, the Warsaw ghetto had a much more porous information flow. People were moving in and out to the ghetto, and they also received refugees or people who had escaped the mass killings in the east, so they had much more information about the concentration camps, the mass shootings. They had much less of an illusion that they would be able to survive this. And scholars have suggested that it was this knowledge of sure death, when they could not further ignore the evidence that was there, that they would not survive, that led to the Warsaw Ghetto uprising, while the optimistic belief that you would be able to survive if you followed the rules that the Nazi occupiers put in place can help explain the lack of such resistance in the Łódź Ghetto. Of course, today, our situation looks different, and the widespread availability of cell phones, the internet, and social media has had an already obvious effect on mobilizing people for resistance, for example, here during the Arab Spring. But also technologies such as GIS and conflict mapping can be used to circulate information about violence and figure out what is going on where. So here is one example of a tool. I don't know if you see this on the slide, but this is an organization or a program called Ushahidi.com. Some of you may know this from conflict mapping. They were able to put together with Google Maps and messages sent through cell phones, maps of occurrences of violence in the context of the election violence in Kenya. And these tools are publicly available, and they have been used in many other contexts since then as well to spread information about what is going on. So this leads us then to another myth that we commonly hear about genocide from bystanders, which is the idea that we didn't know what was happening. Obviously, the present day increasing availability of this knowledge makes it difficult to hold on to that claim, even more so than in earlier decades where this was also already questionable. But in addition to the availability of knowledge and information about what is going on, there are also social psychological processes such as affective reactions to suffering, cognitive biases that shape our perceptions, that can help explain how people actively avoid knowing what is happening during a genocide, or actively recognizing it as such, even though this knowledge may be readily available and in our face. So I'll talk about two or three such examples. One example is what has been called the collapse of compassion in response to other people's pain. These are images from the UNHCR website, and these are typical examples of what shows up when you do a Google image search for refugees escaping Syria, for example. So what we often see are pictures of children who are suffering, which is difficult to tolerate. It is aversive to us to see others in pain. Additionally, we often see images of masses of people fleeing together, long streams of humans that basically cannot be counted. It is just too many to count, and it is overwhelming. And so what research shows is that witnessing others suffering is stressful in general, but as the number of victims increase that we see depicted, our distress and negative affect does as well. And in order to cope with this distress, we regulate our emotions and experience less empathy when confronted with more victims. So for example, in this study, scholars compared reactions to 1 versus 8 victims. Interestingly, this study found that this happens especially when people know that they will be asked to help. So when they are told you will be asked to donate to the victims of the genocide in Darfur, they engage particularly strongly in this emotion regulation to avoid feeling too much empathy. So this obviously explains decreased willingness to help when we are confronted with what seems to be an overwhelming number of victims to deal with in a way. In other words, although this information is available, we may turn away from it or tune it out because it is distressing and it makes us feel helpless and unable to deal with the situation. Another process, and this is the last one I'll talk about before briefly then touching on the aftermath of genocide, another process that shapes how we respond to cases of violence is our tendency to think in terms of prototypes. We have a prototype for any given category. We know what a typical chair looks like, we know what a typical bird looks like in our region. And similarly, and these prototypes help us organize information and respond more quickly and recognize things faster, more easily. Similarly, our research shows that we also have a prototype of what genocide looks like. And currently, this prototype is very strongly shaped by the Holocaust, and increasingly more now also, to some extent, the Rwandan genocide. What this means is that we may be reacting more quickly to some cases than to others, based on our historically and culturally shaped expectations of what genocide looks like. And we may be more hesitant to acknowledge other cases that do not meet these prototypical criteria as genocide. For example, in studies among people residing in the US, we found that when an ambiguous case of mass violence was described in terms that were rated in other studies as more central to genocide, for example, systematic, large scale, again, the Holocaust prototype, people rated it as more severe and urgent, and they were more likely to support military intervention in these cases, compared to the same case in terms of harm, how many people were killed and so on, that was described in terms that were previously rated as less prototypical of genocide, such as disease or child soldiers. There are other examples outside of these studies we conducted from the real world showing how prototypicality shapes our perception of mass atrocities and our willingness to intervene. So for example, this is a photo of a Bosnian survivor in a Serbian detention camp that was taken in 1992. And this image resembled the prototype that we have of genocide based on the Holocaust. We see the barbed wire, the emaciated bodies. So the close resemblance of this image to the prototype we have of genocide sparked a huge public outcry, and it was arguably one of the factors that pushed the intervention in this war. And similarly, when Gaddafi called for attacking protesters and labeled these protesters as cockroaches, it again reminded the international community of the Rwandan genocide, because we have a prototype of that now as well, and thereby fit our prototype of genocide closely enough that again it arguably may have contributed to the intervention in Libya, or the willingness to support it rather. Now, just a little bit of time left so that we can also discuss, but I want to briefly talk about what happens once the genocide is over. I'll go over a few basic ideas from social psychological research on this topic, and hopefully we'll have more time to discuss this in the Q&A, because this is actually the bulk of what I do in my research and what I know most about. The most important key message is that because of their different roles in the genocide, because of identity concerns, and because of different psychological needs that result, members of victim and perpetrator groups, as well as bystander groups, have different perspectives that often directly oppose each other, which makes it hard to work towards healing and reconciliation in the aftermath of genocide, because we simply see things in a different way. And the aftermath of genocide is a very important form of prevention, given what we know when you think back to Barbara Harf's findings on the crucial role of past genocide as one of the main predictors of future genocide. I will give now three examples of these diametrically opposed needs and perspectives between victim and perpetrator groups in the aftermath of genocide that illustrates how they may collide and why this is so difficult. One is the different psychological needs in the aftermath. This is based on the work by Nerit Schnabel and Ariel Nadler on the needs-based model of reconciliation. They basically posit that victim and perpetrator groups, because of the roles they were involved in, the identities that are involved, have different psychological needs in the aftermath. For the victim group, victimization entails losing agency, losing power, status, and control. By definition, when you are victimized by another group, you lose agency and control over your lives. So in the aftermath of violence, it is then argued, victim groups need empowerment, victim groups need to restore agency. How does this happen? For example, by receiving an apology from the perpetrator group, by receiving respect, by receiving acknowledgement of the victim group's competence and value. This is a very psychological perspective. Perpetrator groups, in contrast, are threatened because of their group's moral image. Again, in our present day, victimization and perpetration and genocide is not anything people are proud of or propagate. So in the aftermath of violence, perpetrator groups need acceptance and they need restoring of their moral image. They need to feel that they are still included in the international community, for example, or accepted by others in their society. How is this achieved? For example, by receiving forgiveness from the victim group, by seeing that their perspective is understood, being accepted. Now obviously, there are several studies showing that satisfying these frustrated psychological needs will increase their willingness to engage in reconciliation. But now think about how these two different needs may contradict each other and kind of be at odds with each other. For example, trying to understand the perpetrator's perspective is often experienced as disrespectful and offensive by the victim group. Similarly, expectations of forgiveness after an apology is also seen as unreasonable and often offensive. Likewise, an apology usually should entail recognition of responsibility for the harm doing in order to be effective. But this is precisely what the perpetrator group will find threatening to their moral image if they have to acknowledge responsibility for harm doing. And this leads me to the next point about the role of acknowledgement versus denial. We know that victim groups ache for acknowledgement. We also know that acknowledgement of what has happened to their group. We also know that acknowledgement of collective victimization of one's group increases psychological well-being. It also increases willingness to reconcile with the perpetrator group. Additionally, in other contexts, in contexts of conflict between two groups, experiencing that the other conflict party acknowledges your suffering in a historical context outside of that conflict increases willingness for compromise. For example, this has been shown in the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. When Israeli Jews acknowledge the Nakba, when Palestinians acknowledge the Holocaust, this has been shown to increase their willingness to engage in compromises and engage in more peace-promoting attitudes and behaviors. However, acknowledgement is not common. In fact, denial is quite widespread, and it has even been considered the last stage of genocide. Denial by the perpetrator group of the harm they have committed is rooted, again, in the desire to see the group as moral. We know that it is particularly strong among group members who glorify their group as opposed to merely being attached to their group in a more critical way. Denying genocide or other acts of atrocities and violence reduces the willingness to engage in redress, such as reparations or really any form of redress after violence. Importantly, denial can take on blatant but also more subtle forms. Denial is not just saying the genocide didn't happen. Denial can also mean not talking about an issue that happened, silencing an issue, simply not making it part of, for example, public education. Here's an example that you probably can't see very well from a textbook of a Canadian textbook. I only found a Canadian textbook. I'm pretty sure you would find this in American textbooks as well. But it basically says, when the European settlers arrived, they needed land to live on. The First Nation peoples agreed to move to different areas to make room for these new settlements. So this is a form of perhaps a more subtle, even though it's actually quite blatant, form of denial that involves simply a lack of recognition of what happens, that involves reframing the events to portray it as something else. And we can find many such examples from many different contexts in society. Think about Thanksgiving celebrations, think about who has a memorial and a museum in DC and who doesn't, etc. So again, this really clashes with each other. If the victim group aches for acknowledgement and the perpetrator group has a strong tendency to deny what happened. Another important point in regard to acknowledgement is also that there are different perceptions of what acknowledgement and denial means. I'll give you one example of Armenian genocide recognition. This is a context where, again, Armenians are fighting for recognition of the genocide for a long time. The US has not officially recognized it. However, there are speeches, for example, presidents have been giving speeches every year for the Armenian Genocide Commemoration Day with statements such as this. This is the one from Obama in 2016. Today, and by the way, I apologize for using pictures of the former president. These were the only ones I could find on the web. But obviously, this is a continuous process and not limited to one president or the other. So this statement read, "Today we solemnly reflect on the first mass atrocity of the 20th century, the Armenian Metsyagan, when 1.5 million Armenian people were deported, massacred, and marched to their deaths in the final days of the Ottoman Empire." Now on the surface level, this seems like a great degree of acknowledgement. It is a US president giving an official speech. He's talking about the Armenian genocide. He's even using the Armenian language. So it seems like a perfect example of recognition. Yet, Armenians were not happy with this statement. Why? Because they say, this is a quote from a participant in a study we conducted on what acknowledgement and denial means to different groups. Armenian Americans were one of them. We also studied Palestinians, African Americans, and Jewish Americans. So they say here, for example, "The United States constantly dances around the issue by finding creative ways to avoid using the word genocide. Last year, President Obama, in his official address on April 24th, referred to the atrocities as the Metsyagan, the which is the literal Armenian translation of Great Calamity. The U.S. government plays an annual song and dance that is very insulting to the large Armenian diaspora here. So it is really important to ask what the victim group actually experiences as acknowledgement. It seems that in this case, what is meant as an act of acknowledgement is actually experienced as denial, because for the Armenian group, using the term genocide, that is missing in this definition or in this speech is really central to what they want for acknowledgement. We think of acknowledgement in terms of memorials and museums and other symbolic forms of acknowledgement that probably comes from the experiences of, I would say, more high status or high power groups, and that is what they want. But our studies suggest that groups that have not experienced widespread acknowledgement actually care much less about these speeches and memorials. They want more basic forms of recognition. They also oftentimes want more practical forms of recognition and acknowledgement, such as reparations. This is something that came out in our data from the Palestinian community, from the African American community as well. Third and last point I will make about the aftermath of genocide is that the time perspective that people have differs and contradicts each other. So for victim groups, historical victimization is often perceived as central and still affecting the present. This is because of the ongoing consequences that historical victimization still has on families, on communities, on people's present-day power and status. It also has to do with the transgenerational transmission of narratives in families and in communities that keep these narratives of violence alive and psychologically central. In contrast, members of perpetrator groups have a desire for historical closure, and they want to see that something happened in the past, that they want to emphasize that this is in the past and over, and that their generation has nothing to do with this act of violence, which is, of course, a strategy to distance oneself from collective guilt and from responsibility. So obviously, these two perspectives on how close in time, how central, how psychologically relevant the events still are, clashes with each other. And this comes out, for example, in a quote that illustrates this dynamic really nicely by an African-American participant in our study on acknowledgement and denial, who said, when asked to give an example of what denial looks like for them, they commented this: often people dislike hearing about slavery because it reminds them of the ugly past that America has. People like to say that their personal ancestors didn't own slaves, therefore they are absolved of responsibility. People also say that slavery is in the past and that African Americans should get over it. What they fail to realize is that practices born in slavery still affect the well-being and social mobility of African Americans to this day. And this is what I want to end with. Thank you for your attention, and now we'll have time for questions and discussion.
They do use it,
but they also use the term genocide. And what is interesting and important is that who says what matters, right? So the same term can be used by a member of your own group, and it has a certain effect. But if a member of another group uses it, it has a different effect, especially in the absence of using the critical G word that is avoided, right? So Armenians see through this and say, well, he's using this term to avoid using the G word, and that is what they pay attention to.
I'm interested in hearing your thoughts about what's going on in Poland and some other Central and Eastern European countries related to changing the image around a certain group in a genocide.
Yes, thank you for bringing up that example. That was actually on one of my slides that I then deleted because of time, but I was going to talk about this as a very interesting case of the triangle that I talked about before, right? Because Poland is often considered a bystander to the Holocaust, but actually 6 million Poles were also killed, 3 million Polish Jews, 3 million non-Jewish Poles, and many people suffered incredible losses through the Holocaust and occupation. So I think this constellation gives rise to, you know, very interesting, conflicting psychological needs. Also, sorry, I didn't mention this, but there were many collaborators, Poles who delivered Jews to the Nazis.
Nazis or blackmail Jews and so on. You're probably aware of that. So essentially we have each role in that triangle taken up, and it's a complicated psychological constellation. We know from research on so-called duels, so this is research that was conducted in the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, where they point out, well, okay, in one context you're a perpetrator, in another context you're a victim, or you can be both at the same time. Now what does that do to complicate this needs-based model of reconciliation, where clearly not everyone is either a perpetrator or a victim group? There they show that when you have these dual roles, usually it's the role of the victim group that takes on psychologically more kind of urgency if it hasn't been acknowledged. So the need for empowerment, the need for recognition of that suffering becomes more important. And I think, Polish victimization during the Holocaust probably hasn't been recognized as widely. So this may be one of the main obstacles that's getting in the way of recognizing the fact that they were also in some other ways, not they as a whole, but some Poles were also complicit. That's what I would argue. I think official recognition of Polish suffering during the Holocaust would probably go a long way in allowing people, giving people psychological space to also accept the fact that some Poles were collaborators as well.
Can you speak to kind of the different roles that post-conflict justice mechanisms have in using different victim perspectives? So like maybe, or retributive justice system versus restorative, focus on truth, reconciliation?
Mm-hmm. So what is your exact question?
Can you kind of talk about the differences in a retributive justice system, maybe more of like a legal focus, a tribunal or a court case, versus a more local justice reconciliation approach, and how that affects different victim perspectives after a genocide or mass atrocity?
Mm-hmm. So to be honest, I am not aware of, or I'm not familiar with research that compares these forms of justice systematically and sees, I guess your question is which would be more beneficial, right? Like,
yeah.
What do victim
kind of
groups want?
Yeah.
Yeah, I am not very familiar with that literature. I do think that it fulfills probably different aspects, different types of needs, right? So, there is a strong need for justice among victims as well, not just acknowledgement, but justice as well. And one of the reasons for that is that people, A, it provides acknowledgement, but B, it also gives them more certainty that the event will not reoccur, right? So it is a way of providing a sense of security or safety, in addition to just feeling that what has happened to you has been officially acknowledged. I would argue from a psychological perspective that if done right, both forms of justice could satisfy those needs. There has been a lot of criticism of, as you probably are familiar with, of both of the more grassroots approaches, which were a response to criticisms of retributive justice. So it's a very complicated question. I know that one of the things that contributes to negative outcomes of these more grassroots types of justice mechanisms, such as the Gacaca in the Rwandan genocide or Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa, is when they see perpetrators as not showing regret, as not really acknowledging what happened. So again, I think this issue of acknowledgement is a crucial factor there. So I'm kind of meandering around your question, but I think, and actually Gabe Toos here in the audience has written his dissertation on the topic, so you might talk to him about it. But I think from a psychological perspective, the answer would be that each of these two forms could provide something important to victim groups, but we have to be really aware of the pitfalls and dangers and how it can backfire when it is not done right, such as allowing the perpetrator during these restorative justice sessions to, mock the victim group, for example, as it has happened.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Dolhoff. Excellent presentation. I'm particularly interested in this portion of the prototype
mm-hmm.
that you mentioned, and
mm-hmm.
so my question is whether you ever get questions about how that is a form of denial.
Mm-hmm.
For example, when we use the Holocaust,
mm-hmm.
it insinuates that it's the only one.
Mm-hmm.
the Holocaust or the Rwandan genocide. So we mark other genocides with ethnicities or geographical locations, but when we say the Holocaust, are you ever asked whether that too is a form of denial, especially since, like, for example, the genocide of the Herero people of Namibia, the Jewish Holocaust was predicated on about 90% of the Herero people were wiped out using the exact same tactics. And why is that not called, like, the Herero Holocaust?
Yeah.
So do you ever encounter that in your work?
Yeah, absolutely. In my participants' responses, for sure. So, as I said before, this larger study I did among Jewish Americans, but also Armenian Americans, Palestinian diaspora, and African Americans, there were many, many mentionings of the Holocaust and kind of this competitive victimhood that is that acknowledgement, like differential acknowledgement of different victim groups, also has a negative impact on relations between different minority groups and minority-minority solidarity or conflict. So there's a study, for example, among African immigrants and Muslims in Europe, showing that this strong prevalence of Holocaust recognition, but not recognition of colonialization, for example, in Europe, contributes to competitive victimhood and like less positive, or more negative attitudes towards Jews, anti-Semitism, and so on. In that context, people compete over recognition, and so it's really harmful. And I slightly mentioned like the difference in who has a memorial in DC and who doesn't, right? Why do we have a Holocaust museum but we don't have a memorial to slavery, for example? Why doesn't the Vietnam memorial include actual Vietnamese victims and so on? So those issues people pay attention to, obviously, and it contributes to tension between minority groups as well, in addition to complicating relations between victim and perpetrator group. Unfortunately, I think, the prototype of the Holocaust often gets, or the Holocaust and now also slowly some other genocides, but the Holocaust is probably still predominant in the prototype. It often gets reinforced though in this competitive victimhood, because what I have seen in my participants' statements is that they will then often try to prove through numbers or through describing, the presence of concentration camps in the Armenian genocide, or the number of deaths in this case or the other, that it is like the Holocaust, right? So they will use this prototype and compare their group's experiences because they know this is how you get recognition, but then at the same time it reinforces that prototype. So yeah, I think the prototypicality of genocide is a big problem. It creates a lack of acknowledgement of many different cases, as well as conflict between different minority groups who could otherwise perhaps unite.
And one more thing, if I may, if there's time. I found it really interesting and ironic, the slides you showed about the study. I think it was in Fox magazine that showed that 99.5% of Americans, the dehumanization slide, what I'm referring to. I just found that ironic because, of course, our history here, where it's enshrined in the Constitution that certain people were 3/5 of human beings at a time when the majority of the population was that particular ethnic group. So it's just like perceptions and American and what is American and how that's perceived. I found quite interesting too in that poll. So
yeah, the ideas live on.
Findings that you described in terms of needs of victims and perpetrators, are they equally applicable to cases of other mass atrocities? Is it appropriate to say mass atrocities are a range, there's a range of those as well, but the kinds of behaviors that can contribute to genocide are similar? How applicable is it to a range of atrocities? And then secondly, for people, because we're in Congress, and we actually, members are being asked to address both some prevention issues on mass atrocities, but also the after effects in Syria, in Iraq, in the SCVs, what policy recommendations, could you say more about the importance of recognizing these aspects for people who, for members of Congress who need to address these situations around the world?
I'll start with the second question. I think the data we have from this analysis that the political scientist Barbara Harf did, looking at 126 cases of regime collapse between 1955 and 1977, where she was able to differentiate, to find the factors that explain which of these cases resulted in genocide and which didn't, and prior genocide was one of the six predictors. I think that is probably the most convincing evidence for policymakers, because it's kind of hard and objective data. So that is one factor that I would stress. It can then be joined by psychological research showing that the aftermath of genocide continues to affect victim and perpetrator groups in different ways that contribute to cycles of violence. For example, one topic I didn't talk about, but we know that in the aftermath of violence, victim groups develop, we have a need to make sense of everything, so we develop ideas about why something happened to us, and we transmit these experiences in what I have called victim beliefs, right? So there are different ways in which we make sense of what happened to us. One of the most commonly studied victim beliefs is what has been called competitive victimhood, especially when your group's victimization has not been recognized, and especially when you are in conflict. Groups will tend to focus on how their group has suffered more than the other side, or how groups are perpetual victims over history. And each of these victim beliefs have been shown to support violence against the other conflict party, or hostilities towards other groups. So this is one way in which violence becomes perpetuated. If you don't address the legacy of violence, then this, sense of injustice and perpetuated violence against your group, also, through continued denial or through lack of justice, will further strengthen victim beliefs, and victim beliefs predict further violence. So those are some of the processes that one can use to help persuade people that it is really important to pay attention to the aftermath of violence as well. And your first question was about
the applicability of your findings to mass atrocities other than genocide.
In terms of the psychological needs or other?
And the need to address consequences, address legacy.
The studies I cited were from a range of different contexts that would not be considered genocide by many people.
I raise it because it sometimes it feels like there's a... sometimes groups that are being victimized, or populations that are being victimized, seem to take away a lesson that until they are recognized as being the victims of a genocide, mm-hmm. somehow it's a lesser, what's happened to them is a lesser
right.
concern. And that's not a view that we share, for example, but it's, it shouldn't be necessary to have atrocities rise, or victimization rise to the level of the legal or technical definition of genocide, for there to be a concern about these kinds of both causes and consequences, I guess. Is that true?
Yes, and this is why in the beginning I also made this distinction between genocide and mass atrocities, and that from a psychological perspective, that difference actually doesn't seem to matter.
Okay.
Because we do have data from many contexts that are not prototypical genocides, that are not acknowledged genocides, from the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, for example, or war in Liberia. There are a range of studies from different contexts that converge to show very similar processes and needs. The one area where I think it does play a role, whether it is considered genocide or not, is when we're talking about acknowledgement and denial, because for these reasons, groups want to have it labeled a genocide. So this is where it does matter what people, whether people call it a genocide or not. But in terms of trauma, in terms of transmission of victim beliefs, of narratives of violence, and how this affects vengeful attitudes or lack of willingness to reconcile, all of that is quite similar across a range of different types of violence.
What do you think, or what is the role of social media in the way that we are reacting and are setting up interventions for more recent acts of war versus older ones, or like refugee issues and refugee camps and the conditions of refugee camps, perhaps current ones as opposed to older ones?
Well, I mentioned this very briefly. I think it can have a little bit of a double-edged sword, right? So it's positive in that we now have much more information, and we know that information matters in, getting people to resist, for example. Thinking that, oh, it might not be as bad as we think is one of the factors that reduces resistance, and obviously it has effects for intervention as well. So yes, more information is good. On the other hand, though, I talked about the collapse of compassion and this, flood of information and images and exposure to so much suffering and so much violence can also lead people to turn away from it in order to, deal with the feeling of helplessness that we have in that case, and because it is aversive. And then furthermore, the role of prototypes and how we decode this information and, which images are shown and how they, which effect they have, that also further complicates things. So a typical social scientist answer is it's complicated. it has positive effects on the one hand, but we also have to think very actively about how to counter this tendency to be numbed by the information and turn away from it in order to cope with our feeling of helplessness that develops because we have so much more knowledge now and exposure to images.
My question is on post-genocide society and how there's repair. And my example is being in Rwanda, talking to a woman, telling me a horrific story with two other friends there, and they're chatting, just like normal. And I realize she's telling me an awful story. They have their own horrendous stories, and that everyone who's at least Rwandan in this country either has sort of the victim, the perpetrator, or the returned refugees, mm-hmm. so they also have, this traumatic experience. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking, especially compared to here, where we jump to therapy, mm-hmm. Very easily, how does a society or such a extremely high percentage of the people have these traumatic experiences? How do they move on?
Yeah, Rwanda is a complicated case, especially when we think about acknowledgement and denial, because there is a selective acknowledgement of violence against Tutsis, but not the violence against Hutus in the aftermath or moderate Hutus during the genocide. So it's complicated from that perspective. I actually have been involved with a large-scale attempt to, exactly address this issue of how do we heal a society that has suffered on such a large scale. We can't send everyone to individual therapy. And also, all of the attempts by Westerners coming in to provide some kind of psychosocial intervention have also been problematic, right? Because they address trauma from a particular cultural perspective and completely ignore that this could actually be doing more harm in some ways, bringing back the ghosts, as was sometimes said, for example. But one of the projects that I have been involved with in the past was a radio reconciliation program that is based on psychological theories of how violence evolves, the work by Erwin Staub, and also clinical psychologist Laurie Perlman's work on trauma healing, along with local knowledge about this in this context. So this radio program has now been running for about, it's definitely more than 10 years. Anyway, a long time. And essentially what it is it's based on edutainment, education and entertainment. So the idea that you take an entertaining soap opera with all the ingredients of a regular soap opera, love story, village pool, jokes, village drunkard, all of that, characters that people can identify with, good guys that turn into bad guys that turn into good guys, and so on. And you use this to model and to teach about how violence evolves and what you can do about it, and also about the effects of trauma and what you can do about that to help neighbors heal and so on. How you can support a friend who is suffering from, you know, how to even recognize what a what trauma might look like. So essentially, the soap opera uses a series of psychological messages based on, you know, evidence, theories, and so on, and embeds it into the soap opera so that in every soap opera episode, you have one or two of these messages that are being taught through through the soap opera, through modeling particular behaviors. You hear someone describe their symptoms, and then someone else commenting on them and talking about, like, oh, well, maybe they won't say that is trauma, but, you know, they explain in lay terms what that is, so that you can identify and deal with it. And also, you know, normalizing why did violence occur. This is not God's punishment, but this happens in many different societies, and these are the steps how it occurs, and this is what you can do to stop it early on. So those are the kinds of ideas that are embedded in the soap opera. It's a radio soap opera, and approximately 90% of the Rwandan population listens to it. It's called Musikiweya, and it has been conducted in other countries in the Great Lakes region as well. I know that other NGOs, like, this is the work by Radio Laban of Valencia. There are other NGOs, I think, Search for Common Ground, some other NGOs that do very similar kinds of edutainment programs in order to take this kind of, yeah, public healing approach, if you wish. So that's one strategy that I am aware of that has been used. And of course, you know, other kinds of public education that can be provided through workshops with leaders or community leaders who then bring it back to their communities and so on. So one has to get creative and find, you know, other means of dissemination of knowledge.
All right. Well, thank you everyone for attending. I will follow up with all of the relevant materials. You can also find the recorded video on our YouTube channel. Thank you so much to Congressman McGovern's office, to Kim Stanton, the Tom Lantos Human Rights Commission, and especially our speaker, Dr. Johanna Wohlhardt. I learned a lot today, and thank you for coming.